Hello and welcome to the first part of this multi-part series, in which I explain the most basic concepts of our current economic system. I hope that at the end of this series, you will understand the most important macroeconomic headlines, form your own opinion on how the global economy might develop, and how these developments would impact your own life. Before we begin, a word of caution. I do not have any formal training in economics, and I'm an economist only by calling, but not by degree. My actual background lies in mathematics, and all information presented here is based on my own research from various sources. So while I will try to be as accurate, complete, and unbiased as possible, I cannot guarantee any of these three things, and it is, as always, up to every individual to be skeptical and to do his or her own research. If you find any important omissions or errors, feel free to contact me or point them out in the comments section. In this first part of the series, I explore two questions that are almost as simple as a toddler asking, where do babies come from? But which are hardly ever asked by any human being of any age, much less answered to a satisfying degree. As it is often the case with simple but fundamental questions, they have the effect of revealing powerful truths, especially when they are overlooked or ignored by a large part of society. Those two questions are, where does money come from? And why is perpetual economic growth so important? I will show that these two questions are linked in a quite profound way. But before we dive into the subject matter, I'd like to invoke Bertrand Russell. While none of the concepts I will present will be technically difficult to understand, they might still be hard to believe for some. I therefore ask you to take Bertrand Russell's advice, which is a guiding principle in my life, to heart. When asked what he would like to tell future generations, he said, "When you are studying any matter, or considering any philosophy, ask yourself only, what are the facts, and what is the truth that the facts bear out? Never let yourself be diverted, either by what you wish to believe, or by what you think would have beneficent social effects if it were believed, but look only and solely at what are the facts." So, let's turn to the first concept, which will serve as a basis for most of the other concepts. It is the balance. Most people know that a balance sheet has two sides, that they, as the name suggests, have to be in balance, and that companies usually have to create a balance sheet at least once a year. But one does not have to have an actual balance sheet to have a balance. In fact, we can think of the balance of an individual, such as you or me, or an institution, like the government of a country, since the idea of a balance is to list all assets and liabilities of a certain entity at a specific point in time. How is the balance sheet structured? It has two sides. Both sides contain various items with cash values. The sum of all cash values of all items on one side is equal to the sum on the other side. The left side contains all assets that the entity in question owns. Typical examples are buildings, machines, goods produced, and cash, but also less tangible things, like loans to other parties. In short, a financial asset is anything that is owned and that can be sold for money. The right side is split into two parts, liabilities and owner's equity. Typical liabilities are bank loans or bonds one has issued. In general, a liability is any kind of promise one made that one would pay a certain amount of money or deliver a certain good sometime in the future. In case you do not know what a bond is, it is hardly something mystical. A bond is an IOU, that is, a formal promise. It is being sold for money in the present and usually promises to repay more money at a later date. Anyone can create a bond. Just take a piece of paper, write a date and a certain amount of money on it, and state that you will pay the owner of this paper that amount of money at the specified date. Sign it, and voila, you have created a bond. Now all you have to do is go into the market and see how much people are willing to pay you for that legally binding promissory note. That is in fact how many companies and most countries finance themselves. Often bonds are structured in such a way that instead of one big repayment in the end, one pays the interest on a quarterly or annual basis and returns only the original principal at maturity. These payments are called coupons because in the old days it was actually a part of the original bond which you could clip off to claim the partial payment. But back to our balance. The only thing left is owner's equity, or just equity in short. Unlike all other entries in the balance sheet, Owner's equity is not some fixed value, but rather it is the difference between assets and liabilities. In case of an individual, it is also often called the net worth. For companies, it is called the book value, which is not to be confused with the market capitalization, which is the amount of money the market says that the company is worth, which is usually higher because there is a certain value in the configuration of the asset that is not reflected by the balance sheet. But I digress. So equity is the amount of money the owner of the entity would have left if he were to sell all the entity's assets and pay back all its liabilities. A final way to look at a balance sheet is this. You can look at the right side to find out where the capital came from, and on the left side to see how it was invested or put to use. There are three definitions which often come up when talking about balances: solvency, liquidity, and leverage. To be solvent simply means to have more assets than liabilities. In other words, to have a positive equity. If your equity is negative, that is, you owe more than you own, then you are insolvent. Liquidity, on the other hand, simply means that you have enough cash at hand to pay your current bills. In reality, it is usually not a binary term the way I have defined it here, but rather a ratio. But we will simply say someone is liquid as long as he can pay all parties that have a claim against him at one point in time. Finally, leverage is the ratio of assets to equity. The term leverage is a good illustration of its actual effect. In the real world, you can only lift a certain weight with some limited amount of force, unless, of course, you are in possession of a lever. If the lever is long enough, you can lift any kind of weight. In this analogy, the weight is the assets, while the force is the equity. The term leverage appears in many financial contexts. Sometimes it is also defined as liabilities to equity. But it always implies that one is somehow using a certain amount of capital to influence a larger amount of capital. Now, let's look at two simple examples to get a better understanding of these three terms. This first example is as simple as it gets. We see the balance of person X, who owns $100,000. Perhaps he has been employed and saved up this money, or perhaps his well-to-do uncle passed away and he inherited it. Notice that X does not own anything else of value. No house, no car, no cell phone. According to this balance, X is even naked. If he weren't, he would have to find his clothes in his balance somewhere. But he truly is as free as one can be, because he does not owe anybody anything either. So X has a one-to-one leverage, since nobody has any claims against him. And since he is flush with cash, he is obviously liquid and also solvent. In this second example, X is not in such a great position. He still has his 100 grand, but he also owes A and B a substantial amount of money, more than he actually has. In this example, his equity is minus $10,000. He is insolvent, but he is still liquid to a certain degree. If either A or B were to ask for their money back, he could pay up. But as soon as the other one also wants his money back, X will have to admit that he is $10,000 short. He has become illiquid. So illiquidity is a necessary result of insolvency, simply because one runs out of assets to liquidate to pay one's debts. But one can be illiquid without being insolvent at all. The problem is that solvency can only be judged if one can actually take a look at all the assets and liabilities of the entity in question. And even if the entity itself publishes its balance sheet, one still has to place one's trust in those published numbers. More on that in a second. So, illiquidity is somewhat of an indicator whether a certain entity is financially healthy, that is, solvent, or not. The reasoning being, as long as someone is able to come up with the money when requested, it just can't be that bad, can it? An analogy would be, liquidity is to solvency as red cheeks are to being alive. Usually, if one is alive, one has red cheeks. That is, as long as one is solvent, one is also liquid to a certain degree. Also, sometimes someone is alive but anemic, and therefore his cheeks tend to be rather white, even when in excellent health otherwise. But what usually does not happen, though, is that someone is dead and his cheeks stay red for much longer. But exactly that is the case when some economists speak of zombie banks. They are saying that those banks are actually insolvent, but they are given the appearance of life through liquidity infusions by central banks, in the hope that they would actually recover. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. One last term that is worth mentioning in this context is the term Ponzi scheme. It derives its name from Charles Ponzi, who became infamous for using such a scheme to defraud a large amount of money. In a Ponzi scheme, investors are enticed to invest their money with the schemer, usually with the promise of high returns, say 20% interest per annum. But instead of investing the money, the schemer simply pays his investors their dividends by giving them back their own money, and taking a large chunk for himself, of course. Impressed with the returns, more investors flock to the schemer, and he thus invests their money just as wisely, that is, uses it to pay off his previous investors. The scheme collapses as soon as money stops flowing in fast enough, or as soon as some of the investors get suspicious how such stellar returns are actually possible, and start to dig a little deeper. Or try to pull out their investments, and find that they are all but gone. Let's look at an example of a very small Ponzi scheme, comprising only the schemer and three investors, and let's see how the balance sheets of the involved parties change over time. The first step for the schemer is getting A to invest $10,000 with him by promising A a return of $2,000, or 20% per annum. So A gives the schemer the cash, and in its place puts another asset in his balance sheet, a loan for the same amount. The Ponzi schemer, on the other hand, gains the $10,000, but also a liability of $10,000 to A. Then, over the course of the year, A tells two of his friends that he found somebody who was willing to pay him 20% on his money, and both are interested, but also skeptical. In the meantime, the Ponzi schemer spends $2,000 on fancy restaurants. After all, he wants to profit from his scheme somehow. At the end of the year, he pays A his $2,000 in fake dividends, which leaves him with an obligation of $10,000 to A, but only with $6,000 in cash. He's already insolvent. But A is not aware of that. He believes that the $2,000 he received are actually on top of the $10,000 he should be able to withdraw. Now that A apparently really made money with his investment, his friends B and C decide that they do not want to miss out on such an opportunity, and also invest $10,000 with the schemer. The schemer is still insolvent, but he's more liquid than before. Another year passes, and the schemer again uses $2,000 to fund his standard of living. Again, he also pays his investors $2,000 each in alleged dividends, leaving him with $18,000. Now A decides to pull out his money because he wants to go on a trip around the world for a few years. The schemer complies and A leaves the picture. His friends in the meantime did not tell anybody else about the incredible investment opportunity they found. But seeing how everything worked out for A, they are now more convinced than ever that their investment is a sound one. They decide to keep their money with the schemer for at least another year. So another year comes and goes, and another $2,000 are spent on luxurious food and drink. Again, fake dividends are being paid, leaving the schemer with a meager $2,000, but $20,000 in liabilities. Since he could not attract any new investors, his scheme is on the brink of collapse, and when B suddenly asks to get his money back, he's finally found out and has to run. Now, reality dawns on B and C. Even if they manage to get their hands on the remaining funds, they will both have suffered a loss of 50% of their original investment. And those 50% do not even include the opportunity cost of 2 years of foregone interest. So A and the schemer profited handsomely from the Ponzi scheme, while B and C had to shoulder the losses. A Ponzi scheme is also often called a pyramid scheme, because for it to continue, it always takes a new, larger wave of investors, so that the previous investors can get their money back. In terms of solvency and liquidity, a Ponzi scheme is insolvent pretty much upon its inception, but usually liquid right until before it collapses. It also uses the "I am liquid, therefore I am solvent" makeup to fool its investors. The most recent example, and also the largest known financial fraud in US history, was Bernie Madoff's scheme. I hope the basic notions of solvency and liquidity are now well understood. Let's have a closer look at leverage and its effects.